This video is brought to you by Squarespace. From websites and online stores to marketing tools and analytics, Squarespace is the all-in-one platform to build a beautiful online presence and run your business. Check out Squarespace through the link in the description below. More on them in a bit. So, in the video today, we are answering a viewer question because ZU89, not sure how that's to pronounce it, ZU, but I hope I did okay. He asks, or she maybe asks, when I was a kid, we used to blow on Nintendo games if they didn't work, and I've always wondered if this actually did anything. Well, let's get into it, shall we? Once upon a time, a seemingly universally known trick to get a Nintendo game cartridge to work was to simply pull it out, blow on it, and then reinsert it. If this didn't give the desired result, the process was generally repeated until the magic happened. For the truly desperate among us, blowing inside the console opening itself was common practice in the hopes that this would finally get the game to work. The general rationale for why this worked was that it gave a better connection via blowing dust off the many pins. So, this all brings us to the question of the hour. Did blowing on cartridges actually do anything? To begin with, it is true that the root of the problem in question was almost always a bad connection between the internal connector and the pins on the game cartridge's internal board. This was a notorious issue on the NES particularly, which used a so-called zero insertion force, ZIF, 72-pin connector. The particular insertion design for the NES was inspired by VCRs, the idea being to differentiate the NES from top-loading consoles of the day, giving kids a loading method they were already familiar with, and potentially reducing the chances of kids breaking something when overforcing things, as occasionally happened with top-loader designs. The ZIF connector here used pins made of nickel that were bent slightly to give a spring effect. When the cartridge was inserted, they would bend slightly and then spring back when the cartridge was removed. There are a few problems with this mechanism, though. To begin with, given very frequent insertions in an application like the NES, these pins were prone to losing their spring effect relatively quickly. Further, to achieve close to the stated claim of zero insertion force, the pins on the ZIF connector weren't that strongly springy to begin with. On top of this, the pins on the cartridges were usually made of copper, making them already prone to eventually developing a nice layer of patina. Think the green on the Statue of Liberty here, whether you blew on them or not, further making a good connection less reliable over time. Moving on to the seemingly universally known trick of blowing on the pins, both inside the case and in the cartridges themselves, well, this would impart moisture onto the metal, significantly increasing the development of forms of corrosion, as well as potentially resulted in dust and other particles sticking to the pins. This can also very quickly result in the growth of things on the pins, like some sort of gamer-inspired petri dish. And while you might not think that the moisture from your breath could really make things much worse, gaming guru and host of the DP podcast, Frankie Vitarello, gave a good example of just the effect that this could have. Vitarello took two copies of the game Gyromite, one to be blown, the other to sit around on a shelf in the same room as the other. He then blew on one copy 10 times in quick succession each day, essentially in the same basic way that gamers the world over would do when trying to fix the game when it doesn't work. Certainly, a much bigger sample size and more detailed data would be needed for more definitive results. For example, it would be interesting to track the number of failures after insertion of a game, along with other things like the number of blows and the humidity level over time. However, this much more basic experiment did very clearly demonstrate the significant effect that blowing on the pins has, with the blown pins developing a clearly visible layer of something over the course of the months and the 300 blows. Vitarello's conclusion here was nicely summed up as such. Could this be cleaned up post-test and return to 100% working condition? Sure, probably, but right now, it's f***ing gross. It should be noted here that while the pins on the games could have relatively easily been cleaned, the pins on the ZIF connector inside the console are not quite as easily restored to their former shiny selves without taking the console apart, making blowing inside the console itself an even worse idea. Fortunately though, today, replacement ZIF connectors are both cheap and easy to install if you have to take apart the console anyway. It is perhaps no surprise from all of this that when this blowing method of fixing cartridges that weren't working in a given instance became popular, Nintendo themselves started explicitly stating in their NES game pack troubleshooting, "Do not blow into your game packs or systems. The moisture in your breath can corrode and contaminate the pin connectors." And while bad connections did become less of a problem with the release of future consoles like the Super Nintendo and the N64, occasional blowing before insertion was still a thing, resulting in Nintendo actually putting a message on the back of every N64 game cartridge, again saying not to blow on the pins. In the end, unless there was a significant and very visible layer of dust or other debris on the pins, blowing on them wouldn't have accomplished anything useful outside of a bit of moisture from your breath, maybe helping to get a slightly higher probability of a good connection on insertion. But even this potentially extremely minor benefit would be significantly outweighed by the long-term downsides of blowing on the pins. The real benefit of this blowing method was seemingly just that you were removing the cartridge and putting it back in, thus reseating it and giving the potential for a proper connection. Finally, funnily enough, while the blowing method was seemingly universally known, despite it not really doing anything other than making the problem worse long term, there was one other drastically less known fix for the issue that actually did work in some cases. This was wedging something like another game pack in the console between the game and the top of the slot. This put added pressure on the loaded cartridge, which could, if done right, add pressure between the ZIF connector pins and the pins on the game board, thus making a better connection. Alright, so this technology, it might all seem rather dated what computer games have become, but one thing that will never go out of date is your Squarespace website. I want to tell you a bit about Squarespace before we get into the bonus fact today. Sponsors like Squarespace, they really do make what we do here every day possible. So I mean, if you've even thought about getting a website with Squarespace or anyone else, Squarespace is the best. Please do make sure you use our link below, as it really does make a big difference. Squarespace allows you to create a powerful online identity for yourself, your brand, or your business. It all starts on Squarespace with a beautiful template that you can customize to your heart's content, or you can start from scratch or easily move over from an existing domain, making everything super easy to manage. And once you've gone through that super easy customization process, there are no updates, there's no patches, there's no tech BS that you have to deal with. No one likes any of that stuff. And Squarespace also handle all of that website-y stuff, like do podcasts, yes, mailing lists, yes, social integrations, yep, also that, and much more. Also, they've got 24/7 customer support, so if you do run into any issues, they are there to help you out whenever you've got a question. And Squarespace isn't just about an online presence. You can totally sell stuff or services on a Squarespace site, which is great. Look, if you're looking to do anything online, start a business, pursue a dream, whatever that might be, do it with Squarespace. Head to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready for launch, go to squarespace.com/brainfood and you'll save 10% off your first purchase of a website or a domain. Thanks again to Squarespace for sponsoring. Check them out in the link below this video, and let's get into that bonus fact. Have you ever wondered how the gun in the original Duck Hunt game knew if you actually hit something on the screen? Well, wonder no more. The Duck Hunt gun primarily just consists of a button, the trigger, and a photodiode, a light sensor. When you pull the trigger, this causes the game to make the TV screen go completely black for one frame. At this point, the game uses the light sensor to sample the black color it's reading from your TV to give it a reference point for the given ambient light at the time. In the next frame, the game causes the target area to turn white, with the rest remaining black. If the game detects a shift from black to white from the gun's photodiode in that split second, it knows you were aiming correctly at the target, and so doesn't specifically need to know anything about where on the screen the target is. For games with multiple targets at any given time, the same type of method is used, except multiple target frames are shown. So the game will flash the black reference screen, then it will flash one of the targets, leaving the rest of the screen black. Then it flashes the next target again, leaving the rest of the screen black, and so on. The game knows which target is hit, if any, by which frame is currently being shown when a light shift is detected. Interestingly, if you read over the patent for the NES Zapper gun, one of the main features they point out, which separates their gun from previously patented light-detecting guns, is that in the preferred embodiment of their system, it has the ability to distinguish between multiple targets in one frame. However, that's not actually what they did in the NES system, as noted. In contrast, in a one-frame system, it uses a signal from the TV itself. The signal is in the form of pulses, which signify the start of the horizontal and vertical retracing. The computer hooked up to the TV can use these pulses to more or less tell what area is currently being traced on the TV. It can then time this with a shift in light detected by the photodiode. Thus, with precise enough timing, it is able to detect which target is being hit in just one frame. With this method, the flash can can happen fast enough that it's nearly imperceptible to most people, unlike in the actual NES system, where when multiple targets are shown, most people can perceive the flash. The NES system did use the vertical retrace signal to be able to detect the start of each frame, though, but it didn't use it to detect anything about the position of the target, as in the preferred embodiment described in the patent. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below. Also, check out our sponsor, Squarespace. If you do that, it really does help this show, so it's always appreciated. And as always, thank you for watching.